to the Playwrights panel portion of the afternoon. And I'm pleased to welcome the authors of our three plays, along with their respective interpreters. So starting on my right, Rinat Tashimov, the author of Shaitan Lake. And his translator, Bella Shayevich. The author of Where Will I Find Someone Like You, Ali, Raeda, Taha. And to her right, the author of Time Bomb, Nano Riantiarno, and and his translator and collaborator, Ranga Niantarna. So I want to thank you all. I'm so excited by how this all turned out. I feel like the plays all sort of spoke to us in unique ways, in different ways, gave us insights into your artistry and also into different cultures, different worlds. So I'm really thrilled, and I thank you all for joining us and all the work that you put into this. So I want to start by just asking about the context of working and doing theater in your respective communities, your respective cultures and countries. And this, for Nano, is kind of an excuse to show a video. So we're going to start with that.
Thank you.
want to say anything also just about the history of your theater and when you guys got started and your aesthetic mission?
Theater Koma didirikan pada tahun 77.
Theater Koma was established in 1977.
Jadi sekarang sudah 41 tahun.
So it's been 41 years.
Dan di situ ditulis di buku acara 140. Kita sudah 153 produksi.
We have made 153 productions until now.
Dan selama itu ada beberapa kali Theater Koma di apa namanya? Tidak boleh main itu 6 kali.
During that time, we had six times we were banned from performing.
Dan dua kali dibom, hampir dibom.
Two times we received bomb threats.
Ya, jadi memang susah sekali pada waktu itu. Dan kenapa memang Teater Koma ketika saya membuat bom waktu, susahnya luar biasa untuk bikin sesuatu yang lebih merdeka, kesenian yang lebih merdeka.
So it was a hard time to do theater. When I made Time Bomb, it was really hard to create something straightforward in themes of theater and politics.
Dan apa Theater Koma didirikan tahun 77. Tahun 78 sudah tidak boleh. Satu tahun kemudian.
When we were first established in 77, already in 1978 we received a ban. Our first ban.
Boleh. Dan kemudian apa namanya? Sampai ke itu tahun 89.
And in 1988, our performance of Sampai Engtai was also banned.
Terus kemudian saya mendirikan membuat suksesi pada waktu itu. Suksesi adalah pergantian pimpinan presiden pada waktu itu dan nggak boleh.
And then in 1990, he made a play titled Suksesi, which means succession, about the succession of leadership.
Dan dalam 14 hari, terus hari ke-11 sudah langsung dilarang oleh polisi.
From 14 days of performance, it was banned in the 11th day of performance.
Nah, sesudah itu opera Kecoa itu mau berangkat ke Jepang, itu diatur tahun 88. Ya harusnya tahun 91 mereka sudah datang gitu, kemudian kita nggak boleh ke Jepang pada waktu itu.
Oh, and after that, we restage Cockroach Opera, which is the sequel of Time Bomb. It was also banned from performing and also not allowed to go to Japan because people from the Japan Foundation has already prepared the venues for the performance. But no, we're not allowed to go.
Kita seharusnya main di empat kota di sana, tapi memang tidak boleh dan pada waktu ribut sekali. Orang teater pergi ke DPR pada waktu itu dan kita ngomong soal itu.
Yeah, we were supposed to play in four cities in Japan, but there are also people who are banned from performing. So theater artists were gathering together and went to the People's Representatives Council to protest.
Yeah, tapi memang tidak boleh pada waktu itu.
Dan but we still can't go.
Barangkali itu saja yang saya pengen.
That's all he wanted to share.
Thank you. So Raeda and Rinat, you guys don't have videos, but can you talk a little bit just about the history of your work, like how did you end up getting into theater and what is it like to do theater in your country?
Well, I never studied theater. I always had an urge to say something, to talk about, to tell my story. My mother wouldn't let me study theater. She thought I was, much better than that. I'm the daughter of a martyr, and I should study political science and become someone very important. Plus, at that time, there was war in Beirut and in Lebanon in 1982, during the invasion when I went to AUB, she said, "No, I can't let you. The PLO left and there's nobody to watch over you from drugs and alcohol." Because she always thought that artists are druggy and alcoholists. But she always thought I should be doing something more serious. She's been apologizing since then. Anyway, I have I have started at a, I really had few experiences in school and at the university because I was graduated from George Mason University. So I had always this passion for theater and art, and I really worked very hard to become the person who I am now. And I started at a very late stage in my life, but I gave it all my time. And you know, my story is always combined, I mean, a funny story is always combined with a sad story. After everybody died in my life, including my father, my husband, Yasser Arafat, and my best friend, Mahmoud Darwish, and I was left alone in Ramallah, I decided to talk about these people because I had the chance to be surrounded with such calibers in my life. And maybe this gave me the time to write better about what I went through. At 45, I started writing this text, and I had the opportunity to present it. I've been touring since then. I did like 3 plays in Beirut. That's where I always start from. And I started, you know, writing about the Palestinian story and all its reflections from a political point of view, from a human point of view. And I've been managing, you know, doing that. Thank you.
Ну, наверное, о российском театре в целом говорить бессмысленно, потому что Россия слишком огромная.
Well, it's probably pointless to talk about Russian theater as a whole because Russia is huge.
Вот, поэтому могу рассказать только о регионе, в котором я живу. Я живу в Екатеринбурге, это Уральские горы.
And so I'm going to talk to you about the region that I come from. I'm from Екатеринбург, it's in the Urals.
И когда мы ездим в Европу, никто не знает, что такое Урал. Все говорят, дикий театр из Сибири.
And when we go to Europe, nobody knows what the Urals are, so they call us the wild theater from Siberia.
Вот, я работаю актером, вообще основная моя деятельность, я работаю актером, и работаю режиссером Центра современной драматургии, вот.
I'm primarily an actor, and I'm also a director at the Center for Contemporary Theater.
И я ученик знаменитого в России и в Европе драматурга Николая Калиды.
And I am a student of a very famous playwright and director in Russia named Николай Калида.
Он создал такое удивительное явление на российской карте, на Уральская школа драматургии.
He created this very unique phenomenon in the Russian landscape, the Ural School of Playwriting.
Это именно не школа, это именно явление.
And it's not a school so much as really a phenomenon.
Вокруг него собралось более 100 учеников за последние годы.
Over 100 students have gathered around him in the past couple of years. Yeah.
Поэтому в Екатеринбурге ежегодно рождается более 1000 пьес.
And so every year over 1,000 plays are born in Екатеринбург.
Нас легион.
We are legion.
Вот, и я работаю в частном театре. Это абсолютно нетипичное явление для России, потому что все российские театры — это государственные театры, имеют финансовую поддержку от государства.
So I work in a private theater, which is very unusual for Russia, because all of the other, most of the other theaters in Russia are state-funded, and they get money from the government.
В экономической ситуации России это практически фантастика.
In the economic situation in Russia, my theater is basically like a science fiction.
Поэтому мой театр ежемесячно играет более 70 спектаклей.
And at that same time, there are over 70 productions in my theater every year. 70 different plays.
Месяц.
A month. Wow.
Лично я каждый месяц играю около 30 спектаклей.
I am personally in 30 plays every month.
Вот. Поэтому приезжайте, если мало работы, приезжайте работать в Екатеринбург.
And so, if you don't have enough work here, please come work in Екатеринбург.
Oh my God.
Great.
That's it.
Makes us great speech. So let's talk about these specific works. We were, for instance, Kabina talked a little bit about the governmental and social situation in Indonesia during the time that you wrote Time Bomb. So what's the origin story of each of these plays?
Yeah. Memang pada waktu itu saya merasa bahwa orang membuat sebuah teater, sebuah kesenian, susahnya luar biasa. Soeharto 32 tahun berkuasa.
Oh, at the time he felt that it was really hard to make a theater anywhere in Indonesia. Soeharto has been 32 years in power.
Dan Raeda akhirnya masuk penjara. Orang teater itu Raeda masuk penjara dan kemudian di antara itu sekarang ini tinggal saya dan Putu Wijaya, jadi tuanya sama.
Oh, and also our most famous theater person, Rendra, was being imprisoned, and then currently only he died as well. He died a couple of years ago. And then now, currently in Indonesia, only him and Putu Wijaya are left in the theater.
Jadi yang lain justru apa turun. Jadi yang paling muda dari saya adalah umur 55. Habis itu sekolah kesenian ada tapi juga tidak bagus. Artinya belum melahirkan sesuatu yang bagus. Ya. Ya. Justru itu karena bom waktu itu saya tulis supaya paling tidak sesudah itu saya kemudian mementaskan Tripeny Opera, the Tripeny Opera.
He wrote Time Bomb and then he performed Tripeny Opera.
Apa namanya? Asal mulanya adalah karena saya bikin apa namanya sebuah monolog tentang kecoa pada waktu itu. Jadi
at first, before he wrote Time Bomb, he wrote a monologue about cockroach.
Ya, dan itu dibagi tiga, bom waktu, opera kecoa, dan opera Julini.
He then split it into three parts, time bomb, cockroach opera, and opera Julini.
Tapi yang paling celaka adalah ketika saya mementaskan opera kecoa. Jadi intinya itu di mana-mana orang bicara soal. Jadi ketika saya mementaskan opera kecoa, banyak sekali intelijen datang ya kalau mungkin bisa ditangkap, tapi untung saya tidak pernah ditangkap.
So during the performance of the cockroach opera, many intelligence officers came just to see the play, but thankfully he was never arrested.
Ya, jadi yang lainnya malah Raeda ditangkap. Tapi intinya itu. Jadi sebetulnya saya pengen membuat sesuatu yang kalau saya pentaskan. Orang ketawa saja sebetulnya, ketawa tapi di hati itu menjadi sesuatu yang kenapa kita tidak bisa melakukan sesuatu di dalam teater?
Oh, but the point is he wants to create something where people just laugh, simply laugh, but inside their heart they will ask what is wrong with things today.
Jadi pada saat itu habis bom waktu saya bikin The Tripeny Opera, terus kemudian berikutnya saya bikin opera kecoa. Nah, pada saat itu kemudian celaka karena memang orang melihatnya sebagai sesuatu yang menonjol, tapi ketawa orangnya. Jadi pada akhirnya dilarang juga itu sesudah itu.
So after Time Bomb, he performed Tripeny Opera and then he performed the Cockroach Opera. People are still laughing, but they see it as something that is very sharp.
Dan ketika saya bikin Suksesi, itu salah satu anak dari Presiden Soeharto pada saat itu nonton, tapi sebelumnya ada orang nonton bahwa itu tentang dia, padahal sebetulnya bukan tentang dia, itu sebetulnya sebuah ketotak sebetulnya, tapi dia merasa bahwa itu tentang keluarga Soeharto, langsung dihajar pada hari ke-11.
It's also the same with when he performed Succession, there were people who came in to see and then they think it's about the family of Soeharto, the reigning dictator of that time. It's not actually about Soeharto.
It's ketoprak.
It's just ketoprak, a traditional form of Javanese theater.
And what is the particular social context where the area is being demolished? Yeah. Did that correspond to something that was happening in Jakarta at the time?
sangat pada waktu itu sangat terjadi. Jadi apa orang digusur kemudian dari penggusuran itu lapangan golf dibikin atau mall dibikin.
Yeah, the people were, it happened a lot in Jakarta at that time. People were sent away, and then after their houses were demolished, there were malls, golf clubs, and
things like seperti that. Itu. Dan itu terjadi pada satu. Sekarang juga terjadi. Gitu.
It's still happening now.
Happens here. So Raeda, in some sense, your show contains its own origin story because you're telling the story even of your childhood. But what made you, you were saying, I think a moment earlier, that this was the first play that you wrote, yes? So what made you decide to do it as a play, as a monologue, as a one-person show? What made you choose this form, and how did you develop it?
Well, my story talks about a lot of Palestinian families. I tell their story through my story. I always wanted to tell the Palestinian story from a human perspective, my reflection of it and the way I lived like so many people, my generation, how my generation lived it. And I thought that would be the best tool since, you know, is hijacking planes is very difficult now. I can't do like my father did, so I decided to change, you know, the tool. So I went to... I can't do it, it's very difficult and dangerous. So I decided to resort to writing, you know, simply talking about the way I lived and the way how yani I the way my generation shared this kind of living. And I wanted in this story to concentrate not on the hijacking and what my father did. I wanted to concentrate on how families live after their loss, okay? And the price they pay for the sake of Palestine. It's not a rosy, you know, road to go through what we, the children of martyrs or the people who died for this cause. It's a burden, it's really a big price we pay. So I wanted to reflect all the stories in there normal face, you know, because we don't cry all the time, we don't laugh all the time, you know, we go through phases, and I wanted to reflect on that and to talk about all the phases we went through. Really, at that time, there were children, we had friends that wanted to be children of martyrs because we were very, very pampered. And But at this age, you laugh at yourself, you know, when you live through all these wars. I managed to live through the 1967 war when Jerusalem was occupied. Then we went to Jordan, there was the 70s war, and then we went to Lebanon. I managed to survive also the Lebanese war by chance, the civil war, and the Israeli invasion. So I guess all this experience I used, okay, and I wrote about from a human perspective in a positive way to show exactly how we lived, you know, this life. And a lot of people around me helped me in writing this. Very important people in their fields, like my best friend, the poet Mahmoud Darwish, had played a very big role in my life in getting me really interested in literature and poetry. Yasser Arafat, I was his press secretary for 8 years. I really knew, he was a school of acting to me. I really knew how to act from him. He was a great actor. But he also was a great father to me, you know, he brought me up. And but everything that surrounded my life played a big part, you know, in my life. And I want to tell my friend here that my first visit, when I lost my father, I was 8 years old. And we had very good relations with Russia at the time. And my first visit was to Artek. You know, I managed to go to Artek. You weren't even born. And we really loved it, you know. And all these, you know, experiences I gathered together through the years. It took me a long, long time. When I was with Arafat, I used to have like a small recorder, and I traveled the world with him, met so many interesting and not interesting people. And I had this recorder with me every time I see, you know, a bunch of Palestinians sitting, smoking and talking and conversing. I would ask them about my father. I would tell them, any one of you knew Ali Taha? And, you know, some people would tell me, yeah, I met him in this place. Yeah, I knew him. Yes, I kaza. And I started recording all these stories. And during the Israeli invasion in Ramallah, I decided, and we were under, we had ish mani' tajawul? Curfew. We had curfew, you know, in Ramallah, and I decided with the 3 months curfew we had to listen to the recordings, okay, and to start writing this play, and I managed to do that, you know, through this writing. A lot of people were, let me tell you, a lot of people were liars. They didn't know my father. So they made up stories that they knew him, because everybody likes to be close to the hero, you know? And they made up all these stories about him. Then I discovered from all the common things that they talked about, because I didn't know him, I got to know him through what they said, what my family said, and through this play. Thank you.
So you perform in like 30 plays a month. So do you write 30 plays a month?
He's gonna talk about all of them.
Нет, я пишу довольно редко, когда находится для этого время. Вот. И вообще пишу пьесы только когда в отпуске, когда нечего делать, там отдыхаю я таким образом.
Well, you know, no, I actually end up writing pretty rarely, you know, when I have enough time, when I'm on vacation, there's nothing else to do.
Вот, и вообще про нашу российскую школу драматургии все говорят, что мы чернушники и порнушники, ну как бы тьма и порнография.
You know, what they say about Russian playwriting is that... Oral playwriting, thank you. We make porn and other dirty, bleak, darkness, bleak plays.
Вот, на самом деле мы все очень разные, нас очень много. Ну и вот именно конкретно моя пьеса «Шайтан озеро», я написал ее 3 года назад. Она просто про мои воспоминания о моем детстве.
And actually, we're all very different, and there are a lot of us. For example, «Shaitan Lake», I wrote it 3 years ago, and it is about my memories of my childhood.
Что я вырос в маленькой сибирской деревне, ее население 60 человек на данный момент.
Because I grew up in a small Siberian village, right now only 60 people live there.
И вот та главная героиня, у которой умерло 4 сына, она действительно живет напротив моего дома.
And the protagonist of my play, who had lost 4 sons, is a woman who lives across the street from the house that my family has.
И женщины, которым уже больше 100 лет, и действительно, когда моя мать приехала, вышла замуж и приехала в эту деревню, им уже было 100 лет, этим бабушкам, и им до сих пор, они еще до сих пор живы почему-то.
And the 300-year-old women, they really are there in the village. They are over 100 years old now, but for some reason, when my mother moved to that village, they were 100 years old back then as well.
В детстве я со своим братом пытался ночью залез в дом одной из бабушек и пытался найти ее паспорт. Паспорта нигде не было.
One night when I was kid, when I was a kid, me and my brother decided that we would break into one of the old woman's houses and try to find her passport. And I searched and searched for a passport, and there wasn't any.
Но мы нашли. Да, но мы нашли другой документ. На нее пришла, на нее пришла, как называется?
But we found another document.
Документ, который пришел во время Второй мировой войны, который говорил, что ты умер, что этот человек умер. То есть пришла этот. Да, то, что она умерла. Да, ей пришла повестка о том, что она умерла во время боевых действий.
But we got another document. We found another document from the era of World War II, and it was a document that she received notifying her that she had died. But then, you know, she said that they sent it on mistake.
И, наверное, на самом деле этот мир этой татарской деревни, он удивительный и странный, и я до сих пор не могу ничего понять, что там происходит, и как, по каким законам там все происходит, но я постарался передать это в пьесе.
And the world of the Tatar village is a wild and mysterious world, and I'm still trying to understand it, and this play was an attempt to try to work with that.
Вот, и я решил, и на самом деле совершенно не важно, какой там сюжет в этой пьесе, потому что лучше бы его там вообще не было, но так как театр предполагает зрительское внимание, мне пришлось его написать, и я взял самый простой сюжет, достойный какого-то дешевого сериала.
And, you know, if I could, this play wouldn't have a plot because it doesn't need a plot. I just wanted to present the world, but because, you know, the rule of theater is that it has to have a plot, I just picked a really basic one that really, you know, is worthy of a cheap soap opera.
Потому что это для меня это не пьеса, это просто дверь в этот мир, и ее нужно просто распахнуть, а дальше можно сделать все, что угодно.
Because for me it's not a play, it's just a door into this world, and it's just you just need to open it, and after that anything can happen.
I have to reevaluate the whole way I teach playwriting. So. I want to talk about what happens when you do international work. To what extent have you had experiences of having your plays done in different cultures, different countries, different languages before? And if so, what's been surprising about that? What have you learned, if anything?
Cockroach Opera dimainkan di Sydney.
Cockroach Opera was performed in Sydney by the Belvoir Theatre.
Itu dan apa namanya? Saya lupa sih, tapi ada beberapa lakon juga yang dimainkan kalau nggak salah di Sydney juga. Tetapi paling tidak itu dan itu buat saya sangat luar biasa karena saya melihat mereka memainkan itu dengan kebudayaan yang berbeda. Tapi paling tidak itu buat saya adalah sesuatu yang bagus sekali buat saya.
For me, it was truly extraordinary because it was performed in a totally different culture. But for him, it was truly an extraordinary experience.
Itu saja.
Yeah, that's it.
Any other thoughts? But well, you've toured your show now to many different countries.
Now I have a dream, you know, to translate my work to Russian. You're so eloquent, you know. Oh my God, that's so хорошо, you know. I love that. When you speak, he doesn't stop. He's so concentrated, and I'm still jet lagging, you know. Anyway, I had the opportunity. I have no problem with my work in Europe or even America. That's what Philip Himberg proved to me, thanks to him and Sundance Theatre Institute. He introduced me to this wonderful world. I was part of the Sundance Lab, and he nominated me to present my play to perform at the Kennedy Center 2 years ago, which was great, you know, seeing my the name of my people, Theatre by Palestinians, which was great. I wished Arafat was there, you know, to see it. I have no problem in Europe or America. The only problem I have is with the Arab world, you know? I get banned there because they get so intimidated by the Palestinian cause. After 70 years, it's not even solved until now. And it's, you know, it's their fault. And their excuses are very, very funny. Some of them told me, I don't want to mention countries, you know, but mainly from the Gulf, you know. Some of them would tell me, you know, you have like sexual insinuations in your play, and we cannot show it here because we don't want people to hear such sexual, you know, harassments and insinuations. And I was really shocked the first time I received this letter, and I thought the Aqsa Mosque probably was, you know, would drive people really horny. I don't know. I don't know what was wrong with the sexual insinuations. I didn't get that until now. But yeah, I'm banned from few Arab countries, and unfortunately. But other than that, my work had been translated into English, French, but not published yet. And I'm really serious about German and Russian. I'm really serious about that. Yeah, we have to talk. We have a lot to talk about. But slowly, huh? Slowly. So, thank you. Yes.
Rinat, have you worked abroad?
А, ну я за границей работаю только как актёр, в Европе в основном.
I've only worked abroad as an actor, mostly in Europe.
Вот, а в Америке только второй раз, и с пьесой «Шейтан озера» я участвовал в программе «Ларка».
This is only my second time in America. The first time was when we did the Lark, the Shaitan Lake at the Lark.
Ну и по поводу какого-то нового приобретённого опыта, ну, именно то, что я побывал в Америке, вот он новый опыт.
And in terms of new experiences, well, coming to America, that's my new experience.
Да, потому что это, я думал, что чем Америка чем-то напоминает Европу, нет, это совершенно другой мир, вышел из другой парадигмы.
You know, I thought that America would be something like Europe, but no, it's a completely different world, it's a different paradigm.
В принципе, я испытал такой же шок, как побывал, когда я побывал в Индии, и то же самое произвело впечатление, мне Америка только в другой системе восприятия.
You know, as culture shocked as I was when I visited India, it's the same effect, but in a different world.
Поэтому я думаю, это новый материал для новой пьесы.
So, you know, this might be a new material for a new play.
And do you have a sense of what you're planning to put into the Shaitan Lake movie?
Да, конечно. Я год работал над сценарием, потому что он, ну, он не похож на пьесу, но он в этой вселенной.
Yes, of course. I've spent a year working on the screenplay from that because it's not the same story as the play, but it's just in the same universe.
Вот и зимой начнется предпродакшн, поэтому я здесь в ожидании.
And in winter we're going to begin pre-production, so I'm all excited.
И надеюсь, когда я сниму этот фильм, я смогу, может быть, представить его здесь или в Колумбийском университете.
And I hope that when I finish my movie, I'll be able to show it here at Columbia.
Great, so let's open it up to you guys. Do we have microphones running around? Let me get that set up first. And let's start with this gentleman here.
Yes, I'd like to ask Mr. Tashimov. You're a member of the Tatar national minority in Russia. It says here you learned Russian as later in life. The characters in your play presumably are Tatar, yet you wrote it in Russian. So in a sense, what we heard yesterday was a translation of a translation. Is this, am I right?
Нет, я писал изначально на русском, поэтому нет, это перевод с русского.
Well, no, I wrote it in Russian, so it's a translation from Russian.
Я уже так давно, как бы, так как все мои родственники, с которыми я общался на татарском, уже умерли, я, ну, как бы, утерял способность писать хорошо на татарском, поэтому я даже не могу, как бы, представить нас, ну, как бы, ну, вот, как переведи.
Because my relatives who speak Tatar have all died a long time ago, I've really lost any kind of ability to be able to write in the way that.
Я могу разговаривать, но это не тот язык, который я не могу на нем изъясняться так же хорошо, как на русском.
I can speak it, but I can't explain myself in it as well as I can in Russian.
Hello, everybody. So, my name is Mohamed Baouch, I'm from Algeria. Sorry for my bad English, maybe. So I want to address my question to Mrs. Raeda Taha from Palestine about the way in which the Palestinian population lives culture and art generally under the occupation, and if practicing culture and is like a priority to save the identity of Palestinians, and if it and criticizing or reshape society, or finally convey the image of Palestinians and the Palestinian cause around the world. I don't know if...
Habibi, sorry, Ma, I didn't get all that, but I can answer anything I want, can I?
Sorry?
I didn't get the question properly. I'm sorry, I didn't get it. Si vous voulez, vous pouvez...
In French.
Oui, en français, peut-être, c'est plus facile. Vas-y, okay. Chérie.
Donc, est-ce que l'art et la culture, de manière générale, représentent une priorité pour les Palestiniens pour sauvegarder leur identité sous l'occupation et surtout pour véhiculer leur cause à travers le monde, dans le théâtre, si vous pouvez...
Yeah.
I don't know if someone can do the translation.
No, it's okay. They will know that from my answer. They will get to know, you know, your question. It's I want to be as simple as I can because I'm a very simple person. I don't like to philosophize things because I live the world as it is. There is no way on earth that the Palestinian identity will be buried and will be diluted, as long as there are people living in Palestine, even under the occupation. After 70 years of occupation, people are still living there, dying, and using many, many forms of resistance, and even primitive forms of resistance. And I think the most primitive forms of resistance are the most successful. One of the forms of resistance is theater. You know, and this is the kind of resistance I use. And I use it in a manner where I tell stories about my people, what they go through, how they live, what they lose and what they gain, and how they die and how they get reborn again. And I think this is a very successful kind of resistance that does not die, and it travels. You know, it travels through the walls, it travels through the world. And I think it's about time that people would know, at least, or listen to the other side of the story. And because of that, and because of the technology and the social media and the films and everything that is happening now, it's very difficult to dilute the Palestinian identity. It is there to remain there, and it will be there. Thank you.
Yeah, my question is also for Raeda. I'm from Bahrain, so from the Gulf. So I can.
Habibi, into the Gulf I love.
No,
your Sheikh Hamay is wonderful. I performed last year in Bahrain. Okay, go ahead.
That's great. Yeah, I can expand on what you said about like why they would want to ban your play. Because I know for a fact, like if my parents and you know my family, they heard your story, they'd be able to resonate with it. Because a lot of people in Middle Eastern countries, they face like similar kinds of oppression. You know, not blatant, of course, not even close to Palestine, but very, very close and very similar. So with these, you know, with these governments and with these agents, you know, systems of power in those countries try to do is, you know, put these like fake, you know, excuses to try to stop these kinds of stories from reaching the people, and it's resonating with the people, and you know, kind of moving them to, I don't know, like come up with plays that are similar to yours, or coming up with forms of resistance that might, you know, overturn them or whatever.
It's funny, right? Because it doesn't work. I think it's very stupid and funny because now with, like I said, the technology, now you can see and you can hear anything.
Exactly, yeah.
Thank you.
So my name is Adela Bolet, and my question is mainly to Mr. Riantiarno. What I saw on your video, for instance, was that the production is very rooted in Indonesian culture and your theatrical tradition. And what happens when it gets translated, and you said it was produced in Australia. How was that play cast? Was it cast with Australian actors? And who was the director, or, you know, were there problems in maintaining sort of the cultural authenticity of your play?
Ya, saya sebetulnya akar saya adalah wayang.
His root is actually wayang.
Wayang. Jadi habis saya bikin lakon ini, berikutnya saya akan bikin Mahabharata.
Oh, after this play, we will be performing again in June 29th until July 8th and back in Jakarta in Indonesia. In November we'll be performing Mahabharata.
Mahabharata, ya. Dan sebetulnya ada dua akar saya, wayang dan Chinese.
Oh, he has two roots, wayang and Chinese.
Ya, jadi dari dua lakon itu saya bikin Si Jin Gui, mungkin sekali waktu saya akan bikin Sangkok.
From those two plays, he created a play, a trilogy, a quadrilogy called Si Jin Gui, and perhaps later he will create a Romance of Three Kingdoms, Sangkok.
Jadi mungkin itu, jadi dua itu yang sebetulnya akar produksi saya. Jadi selalu ada sesuatu yang memang bersumber dari wayang dan Chinese.
So that's why there's always those two roots, wayang and Chinese.
Dan ketika dimainkan di Australia tidak ada masalah gitu. Pada waktu itu justru apa namanya mereka melakukan sesuatu yang sangat luar biasa pada saat itu, dan apa namanya duta besar di Australia pada saat itu adalah orang yang betul-betul memberikan kebebasan kepada kepada mereka pada saat itu.
And when they perform the cockroach opera in Australia, there was no problem, he thinks, because they did something extraordinary, and then the Indonesian ambassador in Australia gave them the freedom to do whatever his performance was.
Semua dibebaskan, Mas. Jadi bagus sekali lihatnya itu, seperti di Indonesia.
He felt like he was watching it in Indonesia.
Hi everyone, my name is Alice Tuan. This is a question for everybody, all the playwrights. You all come from cultures that are very authoritarian. And the United States is now headed that way. So I'm wondering if you have any advice. So that we might survive it or resist it. Can you give us some strategies? Please. Thank you.
Я могу ответить.
I can answer that.
Это ваш личный опыт, вы должны его пережить и извлечь из него урок.
This is your experience and you have to survive it and find your lesson.
У каждого свой путь и каждый несет свой чемоданчик.
Everybody has their path and everybody carries along their own little suitcase.
You know, this Russian man waited 50 years to answer you this. He's taking revenge now. A Russian in New York. And look at me, a Palestinian teaching you lessons of resistance. Well, resist, and you have so many forms of resistance, and learn about the other, please. When I first came to this country, they used to ask me, where are you from? I tell them, I'm from Palestine. Pakistan? Palestine. Ya ammi, Palestine. Pakistan? Palestine. And really, I mean, this is a great country with great cultures, and I think they should learn more. That's me and my friend Philip always talk about this. that they should learn more about the other. And once you know the other, you know how to resist and how to, you know, recreate, reinvent yourself. Thank you. I like this question.
Yeah.
32 years, Suharto is in power, and then he was brought down by the college, by the students, college students.
Dan kemudian terjadi reformasi, artinya baru lagi dilanjutkan, tapi banyak hal yang dari Suharto tuh dimatikan. Padahal banyak sekali yang bagus.
And there were, there came the era of reformation, but then some things from the era of Suharto was banned as well. It was set aside, but there was also something good.
Yeah. Dan kemudian sekarang ini kita dipimpin oleh Jokowi.
Currently we are being led by Joko Widodo.
Dan banyak orang bilang bahwa Jokowi sama seperti Obama.
Many people said that Jokowi is similar to Obama.
Tapi kita lihat 2019.
But we will see in 2019.
Itu ada pilkada presiden.
We will have a general election for president.
Dan kita nggak tahu 2019 tuh banyak orang bilang lebih baik kamu pindah.
We don't know. Some people say in 2019, some people say you should get out of Indonesia.
Tapi saya harus melihat itu sendiri. Ketika Soeharto masih berkuasa, saya disuruh keluar dari Indonesia, tapi saya tidak mau. Saya pengen lihat Soeharto jatuh, dan memang jatuh.
During that time, during Soeharto's era, many people told him to get out of the country, but he doesn't want to. He wants to see Soeharto falls, and in the end, Soeharto falls.
Dan kita lihat nanti 2019. Apakah akan terjadi sesuatu seperti di Timur Tengah?
We will see in 2019 whether something happens like in the Middle East.
Jadi saya pikir masing-masing pemerintah itu memiliki sesuatu yang ya benar dialami saja sendiri. Nanti pasti akan melihat itu sebagai sebuah pembelajaran.
So I think he's right. So you have to experience it and let it be a lesson.
А вообще Раеда права, она говорила за погоду, что надо любить театр и исследовать его, и это вот конкретно наша как бы задача, и, наверное, людей, которые ходят в театр, это тоже ваша задача.
And Raeda is right too, that you should learn and love theater, and you know, that is our task, and probably something that you're interested in too, since you're here.
Saya bilang bahwa sampai sekarang ini korupsi masih terjadi di Indonesia.
Even until now, there is still corruption in Indonesia.
Jadi selama korupsi masih ada, saya tetap akan bikin teater.
So as long as there is still corruption, he will create theater.
Dan
Rachel, did you have your hand up?
Some way it seems to me that it's more actual diplomacy, in that people get a sense of your cultures more than maybe the UN. So I'm just curious your thoughts on to what in a way the power that theater has to tell a very personal story from another culture.
Yeah, I agree with you. We have, I consider us very, very lucky as Palestinians to have two forms of great presentation. One of them theater, the other one is Ilan Pappé. Ilan Pappé is the best. He is a Jewish historian who lives in London now, expelled from Israel, and he is the best spokesman of the Palestinian people. So I consider us very, very lucky. He's even better than a lot of Palestinian spokesmen. Plus theater, of course.
Yeah, saya bilang bahwa justru kesempatan saya untuk bicara lewat teater adalah ini. Jadi tahun lalu saya bicara soal warisan. Jadi warisan Indonesia itu apakah utang atau korupsi?
Oh, so he thinks that through theater he can talk about many things. Like last year, he wrote about a play about inheritance. What is Indonesia's inheritance? Is it just corruption and international debt?
Yeah. Jadi pada waktu Soeharto selesai, korupsi masih ada. Sampai sekarang juga korupsi masih ada. Justru karena Jokowi merasa bahwa korupsi tidak boleh. Artinya kalau misalnya kita melakukan sesuatu itu seperti di Cina, di Chinese gitu, ditembak itu barangkali akan lebih baik. Tapi Indonesia tidak melakukan itu.
Oh, he thinks that right now our president thinks that corruption is something you shouldn't do, but people still do it. He thinks if it's like the Chinese government where you shoot the corruptors, maybe it would be better, but we don't do it.
Jadi intinya adalah selama korupsi masih ada, saya tetap akan bikin teater.
So as long as corruption still exists, he will make theater.
Несколько лет назад я играл спектакль в Варшаве по Пушкину «Борис Годунов».
A couple of years ago, I was in a production of Pushkin's Boris Godunov in Warsaw.
И это было в день независимости Польши.
And it was on Polish Independence Day.
И 50 тысяч националистов на площади перед театром кричали «Русским смерть».
And 50,000 nationalists in front of the theater were screaming death to Russians.
И в это время шел наш спектакль.
And that's when our play was going on.
И да, а спектакль Борис Годунов о том, как русские победили Польшу.
And the play Boris Godunov is about how Russia conquered Poland.
Но это поэзия.
But it's poetry.
И поэтому в конце зрители встали, аплодировали, и плакали и благодарили нас.
And so at the end we got a standing ovation and the audience was crying and clapping.
И я думаю, поэзия и любовь гораздо сильнее этих 800 человек в зале сидящих, чем ненависть 50 тысяч на площади.
And I think that the love of the 800 people sitting in the audience is more powerful than the hatred of the 50,000 outside.
So thank you. I feel like not only the last 3 days, but also just sitting up here and talking together is a wonderful experience in making possible people from different parts of the world speaking frankly about who they are and their dreams and their humanity. And you see both the superficial differences and the underlying humanity that unites us all. And I couldn't have asked for more out of this festival. Thank you for being part of it. Thank you for sharing your work. Thank you for joining.